You are welcome once again.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. You're welcome for today's edition. So we are discussing probability, introduction to probability. In the last two sessions, we talked about the introduction and the rules of probability. We talked about addition, multiplication rule, and conditional probability. So let's discuss this rule now. There are nine of them. Some are very simple, while some are, the other one that they are simple, but the degree of simplicity vary. So just quickly run through 1 to 10, the rules of probability. Those addition and multiplication rule we discussed last time are still part of the rules. So the first one is the bound of probability. Though I just is this rule now listing them, that this is a way of summarization. And that is why I put it last. I put it last because if you look at it, the first one, we have discussed it, even though we didn't call it rule. The bound of rule one is that the bounds of probability is between 0 and 1. So the rule there is that the probability cannot be less than 0. So it cannot have negative value. Cannot say probability is minus something, no. Cannot be less than 0, it cannot be greater than 1. Cannot be 1 point something, so it cannot be more than 100%. That's what you say. So it's between 0 and 1, or 0 and 100%. 1 is 100%. So that is the first rule. The second rule is the law of total probability. That one also will make more sense when we even talk about probability distribution. If you remember, when you look at something like a classical approach, something like coin, if you toss a coin, you see that there are two faces favorable to the coin, and one of the faces will be head, the other will be tail. So if you see, what is the probability of the head? Is 0, is 1 out of the 2, is 0.5. What is the probability of the tail? Is 1 out of the 2 is 0.5. When you add 0.5 to 0.5, it's going to be 1. The total possible probability will be 1. So you understand it better when you get to quickly talk about probability distribution. The same thing, if it is two coins you toss, you see that you have one probability of you getting head for the two of them. That will be 1 out of 4. What is the probability of getting 2 tails for the when you choose 2 coins? That would be 1 out of 4 also. So what is the probability of getting 1 head, 1 tail? It's going to be 2 out of 4. If you had 1 out of 4, which is 1/4 is 0.25, the other 1/4 is 0.25, then this half, which is 1 out of 2, is 0.5. 0.25 plus 0.25 plus 0.5, it will give you 1. The total probability will be 1. For a particular outcome, all the possible outcome, if you calculate the probability of all the possible outcome of the variable, when you add all the probability of all the possible outcome, it will give you 1. That is what the rule 2 is saying, the law of total probability. The addition rule for individual outcome, the probability of an event is the sum of the probability of all individual outcome that event. So this one also is another way of even repeating the same thing. Probability of an event is the sum of all the probability of all the individual outcome. So it's actually repeating the rule two. Then the complement rule, we have talked about it also. Two events are complementary. So you know that if there are two issues, there are two aspects of it. It may be that there are only two possible outcomes. If there are only two possible outcomes, they are complementary. So if we say that the probability of finding you get to the auditorium, the person you pick at random is female. If it's 60%, then the probability of the person you pick at random is male would be only minus 60. So that 60% is 0.6. So for the male will be 1 minus that. So they are complementary. So the probability of an event occurring his probability is complementary to the probability that it does not occur. If you say, oh, the probability of you picking a female is 0.6, the probability of you not picking a female is 0.4. Not picking a female, you are picking a male. So you see, two events, when they are all, there are two possible outcomes. So one is complement to the other. Then another way of complementary probability is that probability of at least one is complementary to the probability of none. So with the complement event is the opposite of the other event. Is the probability of an event occurring is the event not occurring. So the addition rule for mutually exclusive event. If an event, we talk about this one on Tuesday, if an event, if events are A and B are mutually exclusive, they are disjoint. That is, there is no overlap. So the probability of A or B will be probability of A plus probability of B. The general addition rule is that it is in that general addition rule, it is believed that, we may not say it's believed that it's the probability is mutually exclusive and the two events are mutually exclusive, non-mutually exclusive event. In general rule here, probability of A or B will be probability of A plus probability of B minus probability of A and B. I already said it. So this is actually the general rule. But when the rule, the event are mutually exclusive rather, there's no overlap. This A and B meet A intersection. B, there's no intersection, it will be zero. So that is why if it's out of the formula, you see that general rule will be the same thing as this first one. If this component is zero, so the formula will become like the addition rule for mutually exclusive. So this general addition rule, then when the event is mutually exclusive, there's no overlap. In that case, there's nothing like A and B will be zero. That is intersection, there's no intersection. The probability of A and B will not be possible. So like you say, the person is a man, and the center is a female, is a woman. It's not possible. In that case, the probability that that person is a man and at the same time is a female, is a woman, is zero. In that case, that aspect of that formula is out. So the general rule will become like the for mutually exclusive. There won't be that minus probability A and B. Then you come to the multiplication rule for independent event. If event A and B are independent, then probability A and probability B, it just means probability A multiplied by probability B. Just like this one, probability A or B is probability A plus probability B. The probability A or B is under addition rule A or B. It means that at least one of them. Whereas probability A and B is under multiplication rule. So it's multiplication. The general multiplication rule, if event A and B are dependent, then probability A and B is probability A multiplied by probability B provided A has happened. Or probability A and B is the same that probability B provide time multiplied by probability A provided B has happened, whichever way. So that is a multiplication rule. For dependent event, that's the general rule. But when they are independent, you will now see that if you try to work it out, you see that it will come back to this probability A and probability. If they are independent, there's nothing like condition B. A probability A provided B has happened. If A and B are independent, so probability A provided B has happened, it's the same thing as probability A, because either B happened or B does not happen, it doesn't concern probability A. So if you look at it, if you look at that now, it will still come back to the multiplication rule for independent event, where probability A and B will be probability A That is probability P. Now, a conditional probability for any two events, A and B, we are talking about it. If A, B, probability B, provided A as sample, is probability A and B over probability A. We have shown it before. Because probability A and B is a intersection of A and B, since it's provided A as sample, divided by probability A. That is, the denominator there is A as sample. Probability B provided A as apple. In that case, A as apple, probability A is the denominator. So the what the T you are hiring at is that probability A provided B as apple. That denominator numerator would be that aspect that intersects between A and B, while denominator would be A. So that is why it is probability A and B over probability A. Then this last one is the bias rule. That one is just a little bit complicated. It's actually, it's like offshoot of the conditional probability. Bayes theorem say probability B, but A has happened. It's the same as probability B, multiply by probability A, B has happened over probability A. You just play up. What will I call it now? It just like a just play when you just play on for war. But it's very, very important because is what is used in pre and post op probability. Because a pre and post rather, pre and post probability. You know, we have different type of inferential statistics. We have hypothesis testing, which many of us we are familiar with. We have confidence interval. And we also have this bias theorem. We also have this bias theorem. We also have Monte Carlo different, but those two, this bias theorem was admin there. You know, we talk about post pre-test probability and post-test probability, though it has been there. And people have not been using it, but it's like it's coming up now. The commonest one we are familiar with is hypothesis testing and confidence interval. But we'll still talk about the Bayes theorem later when we talk about a different type of inferential statistic. I think it will make sense. See, the Bayes theorem is a formula that describes how to update the probability of hypothesis when given evidence. The logic behind me is that if maybe they say that, before you take your research, you have done your literature review, they say the prevalence of this disease is 50%. But when you do your test, you collect your data now, you may not get the same thing. So what they are saying is that the evidence you had before that was available before you do your test, that is the pre-test probability. So whatever you get from the literature is the pre-test probability. Because that's the best evidence you have. Then when you now do your own, instead of you to just come with your own evidence, the result of your result, you now multiply the probability. If before your test, what you got in literature is 50%. If you now do your own, that is 60%. You now multiply 0.6 by 0.5. To get the multiplication, to get the post-test probability. So you look at it now, that is a way of, the new way of inferential statistics, though it has been there for long. So that's the usefulness of the Bayes theorem. It follows simply from axiom of conditional. If you look at it, it's related to conditional probability. Now, I want us to, because some of these things, we are just describing here the law of probability, the rule, addition rule, multiplication. You will see something like, then you have the complement. We talk about complement. No complement means if the probability of A is this, the complement is the probability of not having A. So it's just like probability of teenage pregnancy is 60%. Probability of not having seen a pregnancy will be 40%. That's the complement of that one. So you see that hand is multiplication rule. Her is the addition rule. Not is the complement. Now, how do we use? Sometimes it's the same thing as bullying logic. Even before you describe it publicly, bullying, actually use it. You call it bullying logic and or not. How is it useful? It's very useful. Sometimes when you are even searching, like a searching literature, you are trying to search literature for your topic. You know that the way you go to the search engine like Google and others, what you put there, if you say, like for example now, say diabetes and obesity, you want to look at obesity and diabetes. If you type diabetic and obesity, what it's going to give you is that it has to be literature that talk about both diabetic and obesity. If that diabetes and obesity is not in the literature, the search engine will not give it to you because you have put and it has to be, that is multiplication we are talking of here. And both of them have to be present. For example, now using and include both your keyword in your search, which we narrow down the result. So if you look at the Venn diagram where we have been talking about, look at the Venn diagram, obesity. There's an overlap with diabetes. It's only when you put, it's only when that literature contains obesity, the word obesity, and the diabetic before it can bring it up. But if it is all, look at the example I gave you, geriatric or elderly. You know, because you know that geriatric is the same thing as elderly. But if you say, okay, geriatrics, hello, you know that anything the road geriatric come up, but elderly also means the same thing, so it will not come. If you put elderly also, so if you say geriatric or elderly, you have to, anywhere the road, any literature that contains geriatric and elderly, at least even if it is either geriatric alone or elderly alone, or both geriatric and elderly, it will come up. That is all for you. It is the same thing if you say obesity or diabetes. So it's going to give you obesity, either obesity alone, or diabetes alone, or both of them. That is all. But if it is and it has to be that both obesity and diabetes is there. For example, this geriatric and elderly, or elderly, like if you put geriatric and elderly, it will not be as wide as this because it's only a literature that made mention of geriatric and at the same time elderly that will come up. So all the ones that just made mention of geriatric alone, it will not come up. Elderly alone will not come up. Can you see now? Or using or we help you retrieve more information and put what we brought in your search. So when you use or, it gives you more information because it is anything that contains at least one of those things you put there. Look at it, geriatric, elderly, bring all of them up. It will bring all of them up. But if it is, and it's only where they overlap that will come up. It's only when both of them are there. Now, the last one is not. Teenagers, not adolescent. Not exclude one from your side, but be careful you may exclude too many ones. So, you know, as in not, you like now, so you are looking at teenager, you don't want there anything adolescent to be had because sometimes they are related. So if you don't want, you are specific that you don't want adolescent teenager. So not will help you remove anything. Even though there will be some literature that contain both teenager and adolescent. So anyone that has adolescent, it will remove it. You don't want as a teenager alone. Now, that is in session. I just described this one, how probability rules apply in Boolean logic. Still Boolean logic, but when you are running analysis, when you are running data analysis, this world, this probability rules also, or is still being used. That's for example now. The cases that usually come to us in medical line is hypertension. You know, for you to define hypertension, for example, before you can say somebody is hypertensive, where there are, when you are doing your research, there are three ways you pick that. Well, you can say two ways, but there are actually three. You know, somebody with issue of hypertension, if somebody has been diagnosed hypertensive before, you just ask if you are hypertensive, if you have issue of hypertension. And because for the fact that you measure the blood pressure that time is normal, doesn't mean the person is not hypertensive. It means that maybe it's controlled. But the issue will tell you, it's hypertensive. Then you have, when you measure the blood pressure also, some will have systolic hypertension, and they will not have diastolic hypertension. Some will have diastolic hypertension, they will not have systolic hypertension. But how do you know who is hypertensive? So because any of them suffers, either the person, you might have measured the blood pressure more than once to establish diabetes. What we are talking about true blood pressure measurement. So somebody is hypertensive if it has systolic hypertension alone. It's hypertensive also if he has diastolic hypertension alone. It's hypertensive also if he has both systolic and diastolic hypertension. It's hypertensive also if he has a history of hypertension alone. It's hypertensive also if it's systolic hypertension and history. It's hypertensive if it's diastolic hypertension and history. It's hypertensive if it is diastolic hypertension, systolic hypertension, and history of hypertension. Can you see? So in this one, the logic you use here is the or. So the hypertensive person is systolic hypertension or diastolic hypertension or history of hypertension. In this Venn diagram, I only show diastolic and systolic hypertension. You will see that if you say how many are hypertensive now, out of if you look at we have 310 plus 19 plus 2 plus 5. Now, the 310 are the ones that are not in any category, they are not hypertensive. But systolic hypertension will be 19 plus 2. 19, maybe 21 people have systolic hypertension here. Can see number with systolic hypertension, 19 and 2. The number with diastolic hypertension is 5 and 2, making 7. The total number of hypertension will be 19 plus 2 plus 5. Can you see? You will not say the total is 21 plus 7. If you say 21 plus 7, you have counted somebody two times. There are those two people that have both diastolic and systolic hypertension, you are counting them two times. And that is why you just say 19 plus 2 plus 5. Or if you say 21 plus 7, you now say minus 2. If you minus 2, it will still give you the same thing. So look at the 19 plus 2 plus 5. It's the same thing as say 21 plus 7. That would be 28 minus 2. It will still give you the 26 here. Now, it's the same thing. This is another example. This one, it should be a key set. Verbal harassment, breast caressing, and a welcome kissing. This one was extracted from somebody's study that just showed the experience from adolescent, teenagers' experience. Female adolescent. Now, we have people that experience verbal harassment here, 39 plus 8 plus 18 plus 31. People that experience breast harassment, breast caressing, 19 plus 8 plus 18 plus 40. People that experience unwelcome kissing, 40 plus 31 plus 18 plus 40. Can you see a lot of overlap? The one that is common to all the three, the people that I explained is there are 18 of them. They experience all these three things. There are 18 of them. The people that experience breast caressing and unwelcome kissing, there are 40 together. The people that experience the verbal harassment and at the same time experience breast caressing are 8. The people that experience verbal caressing harassment like that, and welcome Christine at the same time, that one. The people that are experienced all the three at the same time, they are 18. So if you want to, if you want to know all is the total, you cannot go and add, on their own, add the people that have Baba caressing and experience Baba caressing, bread caressing, Baba harassment, bread caressing, and a welcome kissing like that. You cannot, it will overestimate it. So you have to break it down and say, okay, when you are breaking down, just add all this, it will give you the total number of people that experience all these things. I think, I don't know the time now. I don't want us to go into probability, the probability distribution. I want it to be on its own. So I don't know if there's any question so that we can address it. Any question? Or should I quickly introduce that this time is short, we can quickly, if there's no question, maybe I should quickly introduce probability distribution. Then probability distribution, let's just go straight and go on to probability distribution. Yeah. Yes, talking about probability distribution. Probability distribution is the distribution that showed the probabilities of all possible values of a random variable. Random variable here just means quantity that can take one of a set of mutually exclusive values with a given probability. When you say mutually exclusive value, can take anyone that, for example, now, we could start with simplest thing, the sex. Sex is a random variable in the sense that it can take any of the two mutually exclusive value, male or female, at any time. You meet anybody anywhere, in any profession, in any city, anywhere, the person can either be male or female. So all the people you are going to meet will not be female. All the people you are going to may not be male. So unless if it's only, even in women's convention, it still has some men that accompany them. So the issue there is the value of the variable is much, they are mutually exclusive in the sense that if you have one value, you cannot have the other value. But people you are going to meet, the subject will either have any of them. That is random variable. Think of many things, even weight. You see, you weigh, even though you can have similar weight, but per time, if you weigh 39, you cannot weigh 40. At that particular time that you weigh 39, it's either you are 39 or 40. Oh, you weigh 39, you cannot say, I weigh 39 now, I also weigh 59. No. That's the value. The value of that weight for you per time is a value. So it's a random variable. So a probability distribution is a theoretical distribution that is expressed in a tabular form, graphically or mathematically. When they say something is theoretical, doesn't mean that it's completely theory. Theoretical in the sense that some people have done some research, practical, and they have come with it and published the results, and you are using it, you are assuming that it's, why they call it called theoretical, you are just applying to everybody, assuming that many, for a period of time, many subjects will follow the same pattern. But it was actually gotten from a pattern in the population. So at the time, it was in it was a research that brought it out. But once you begin to use the same thing, it is theoretical. Each probability distribution is defined by certain parameter characterizing that distribution. So there are something that characterize the distribution. The two important characteristics of a probability distribution are: one, the probability of a particular outcome must always be between 0 and 1 inclusive. Probability rule 1, if you remember. Rule 1, probability cannot be less than 0, cannot be greater than 1. It's always between 0 and 1. That's rule 1. So that's one important characteristic of probability distribution. the sum of the probability of all mutually exclusive outcome is one. That is probability rule two. If you remember, talk about rule one, rule two. So those rule one and rule two, they are the characteristics of probability distribution. They are fundamental. Two type of probability distribution. You get to understand it better as we look at the different type of probability distribution. Two types. Discrete probability distribution. Discrete probability distribution and continuous probability distribution. For discrete probability, it is the probability distribution in which we can derive probability corresponding to every possible value of a random variable. That is, that shows that you can know all the possible values and now derive the probabilities of all the possible values. Like for example, now we talk about male and female. We know the possible value are either male or female. Those are the two possible values. And you can derive the probability for male and female. Like in Nigeria, we have six geopolitical zones. Those are the possible value of geopolitical zone in Nigeria. They are six. You can derive the probability that somebody's selected at random in Nigeria is from one of these zones. Because you can calculate it. All you need to know is to know the total population, the population of each zone divided by total population. It gives you the probability of a person coming from a particular zone. So think of this coin, die, and many other things that what you call discrete variable, they follow discrete probability distribution. Continuous probability distribution is a probability distribution in which we cannot derive probabilities corresponding to every possible value of the random variable. It is not possible to know all the possible value because they are infinite. For example, anything that something like blood sugar now, blood pressure, anything they call continuous variable, because they have decimal. You cannot say these are the possible values. All the possible, I see there are 1,000 possible values of blood sugar. No, it's infinite, infinite. It can be, blood sugar can be 60.1, 3.2, 3.201, 3.203, 3.214. Even 60 point something can be in between 60 to 60.1. It will be 60.1 to 60.2 and 60.2. They are infinite number. Because it has decimal. So when you are dealing with variable that you call continuous variable that has decimal, you cannot know all the possible values. But if it is a variable that does not have decimal, you can know the possible value in between a two range. For example, now, a number of children. You can say, okay, number of children, let's say between 21 and 10 now. The possible number of children, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 to 10. There are 10 possible value of number of children. If you are talking of skin color, talk of anything that is categorical or discrete, you know the possible values. When you know all the possible values, you can calculate the probabilities. You're like the tossing coin. There are two possible, if you toss a coin, two possible values. If you toss a die, there are six possible values you can get. If you toss two dice, though that it comes in combination, there are 11 possible values you get. They come in the combination, about 36 combinations that those two dice can combine, 36. But if you look at this, someone, if the value, if you have to calculate the value, is this 7? Is it 8? Is it 11? You score when you throw two drive. There are 11 possible values. Like either be 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Those are 11 possible values. No, it's from 2 to 12. It's not from 1 to, because there are two die. The best, the smallest you can score with the two dice, one on each face, making two. And the highest you can score is C6, making 12. So this value from 2 to 12, there are 11 possible value score you can get with tossing 2 dice. For tossing 2 coin, then the combination that will come to you is in 4, but there are 3 possible aspects. Either both of them are tail, or both of them are head, or one tail, one head. So each of them, the probability differ. So for those are discrete probability distribution, because you can know all the possible outcomes and calculate their probabilities. So you can actually know the probabilities of all the possible outcomes. But for continuous probability distribution, this is not possible. You see what you can know then. You can only know for continuous probability distribution, where we talk about it later, the probability of a range of value. You cannot actually know the probability of a particular value. You can know the probability of a range of value for continuous probability distribution. Under the discrete probability distribution, that's why we have binomial distribution, geometry, or zone, hypergeometry, multinomial, negative binomial. There are more than this here. There are more because they are still just plenty, but these are the common one we encounter in statistics and mathematics. There are a lot of even many people inventing different form of distribution. You know that those things exist in nature. It's people that just okay when they observe through the observation, they come into concept. And that's okay. It's not as if it's more like discovery, not invention. To discover the distribution because they do exist. God has made them. They do exist in the society, in our activity, but it's just for us to discover. But those are the common six discrete probability distribution. And later we talk about continuous probability distribution. I think we can stop here because I wanted to stop. So somebody asked a question last time, talking about 5 smokers came to clinic within a period of 8 minutes. What's the probability that a smoker in a period of 10 minutes? What's the probability that a smoker will come in a period of 10 minutes also? I mean, I was saying the person that it's a little bit complex because we have not reached there. It's not that it's complex, but we are doing it bit by bit. That one is a form of Poisson distribution because it has to do with time, rate of occurrence or something. You know, it's talking of people coming to clinic within a particular time interval. That is rate for you. So the best description is Poisson distribution. And there's an example here, and I explain to you, later, I think when we talk about detail about all this, we get to understand better. I think we stop here. Yes, before we stop, now maybe I'll come. So I don't know if there's no chat. That shows that there's no question. There's no question. So if there's no question, nobody chat anything. But if you have your question, you can ask your question verbally. Ask your question. So that when you ask for a question like this, you begin to wonder why is there no question? Is it that all these things are confusing? Or it's very simple that there's no need for any question. It's very self-explicit. Okay, there's no question. I think can stop here. Let me pause. Let me listen. Why is geometry a discrete probability distribution? Okay, because we just talked about the geometric now, just say just one of them. It's just as if we have not explained because we are still coming the next lecture to explain each of them. Geometric. It describes the number of trials up to the first success. Though it's good for you to even start with something as simpler like binomial. No? The binomial distribution, when there are two possible outcomes, like male and female, head or tail, that's binomial distribution. in geometric displacement is related to that bet. It determines number of try up to the first success. As an example now, if you say somebody can say, okay, you stay in the place, you want to know, in the garage, as motor will be, a vehicle will be passing, when are we going to see one real car, maybe G-Wagon? So somebody sitting in the garage from 8 o'clock, you were just waiting, you were just counting the number of car, but until is as he's counting, maybe he has counted 140 or 500 before he now see G-Wagon. So describe the number of tire up to the first success. Here now, you know, if you look at it, if before you count maybe one or two, you see G-Wagon, that's that summer, compared with another car, maybe you have to count up to 250 before you see that car. You know which one is Riara. Riara, you'll be able to know. So it has to be about counting. So it's discrete. It's about counting. You know, how you differentiate between discrete variable and continuous variable? Continuous is measured because it has decimal. Discrete is counted. You know, under discrete, all those things that we call nominal, ordinal, all these categories are the idea. And what you call discrete numeric, like for example, number of children is discrete in the sense that it's whole number. You cannot have decimal. You cannot say my three and a quarter children. No, it's whole number of people. How many people attended our training? 32 and a half. Who is the half? So there's no decimal with discrete. Number of something. Then the word disc also applied to when you are talking of something like categorical, other categorical variable, like even age category is different from the age itself, the sex category, the geopolitical zone, the state, the ethnicity, the word, G-A-O-N-G, or pediatric word, the department. Think of many things that. Or professional group. These are categorical. They are discrete also. Because if you remember, if you were in the lecture, or one of the lecture on the basic concept now, on descriptive statistics, we talk about summarizing variable, summarizing qualitative variable and quantitative variable. We say that presenting frequency, we use graph and table. When I say using graph, is the graph you use for discrete variable is different from the one you use for continuous variable. When we're categorizing those variables, we talk about quantitative variable can be given numerical value. Qualitative variable cannot be given a numerical value. But we also say that under the qualitative now, categorical, we say nominal, ordinal. When you come to quantitative, we say discrete, continuous. When I say there's another way, because discrete, you just say discrete, continuous. Even all those ones you categorize as categorical variable, they are discrete also. So if some people, they give categorized variable into discrete and continuous. They now put those other nominal, ordinal under discrete. Discrete just means that there's a dealing, is it demarcational? There is a distinct category. So just like when you say number of children, 1, 2, 3. 1 is different from 2. It's not something that has decimal. So is regarded, that one is the number of something is regarded as numerical discrete. There is discrete. Why the other one, they are categorical, they are discrete. So now, it's the same logic that is applicable to discrete probability distribution. All those ones we regarded as discrete variable, they follow discrete distribution, probability distribution. Why those ones we regard as continuous variable follow continuous probability distribution. So geometric distribution is a form of discrete probability. In fact, it's actually, some of them are offshoot of that binomial. It is when the number of sources is very low and the number of clients is high. That is what follows geometry. If you look at it, somebody you want to know when G-Wagon passed. So this car, G-Wagon, what? Because if you look at it, it looks like you are looking for G-Wagon. And for every car that comes now, it's like you are sampling car. Oh, success will be G-Wagon, failure will be not G-Wagon. So is that GS or no? It's binomial. But in this case, it's like you have to count many before you now see 1 year. So what it means that the success rate is very rare. Then for you to even, you just have to have very, very high sample size. So that is, if you look at it, the geometric distribution is like binomial distribution, but the success rate is high, but require higher sample size. Higher sample size means higher number of trial. So that's why I say describe the number of trial up to the first success. So you just describe up to the first success. So is it, people that do dilution, the people that are doing a work in the lab, it's actually the geometric, the what they do is follow geometric distribution. Because when they want to, the strength of something is 1:1. They now had maybe they dilute 10 times to make it ratio 1:10. If they want to make it ratio 1:1,000, they dilute, they multiply the solution by another 10. So it's a form of geometric distribution. Maybe by the time we start discussing deeply, because this thing can be confusing unless you take it bit by bit. So you have gotten it now, okay?
Any other one? Thank
you. Welcome. Any other one? Okay, there's no other question.